life around the world. It's time for In a Mouse, your Disney lifestyle destination with JL, Scott, John, and Nicole. Oh boy!
Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of Inner Mouse, the Vidcast for people who are striving to lead a Disney-driven life. I'm JL from thedisneydrivenlife.com. With me here this evening are John, columnist for the Disney Food Blog, Scott from collectmouse.com, and Nicole, neurotic Disney individual extraordinaire. So tonight we have another episode for you, sticking with the Halloween theme, but whereas last week we were talking about how to have a Disney Halloween at home, tonight we're going to be talking about having it in the park. So yes, we will be discussing Mickey's Not So Scary Halloween Party.
Woo! I'm scared.
It's really not so scary. Oh! It's not so very scary. So for all of you that are watching this evening, that would be the reason why we have John as a pirate, myself as the White Rabbit, Nicole as Minnie Mouse, and Scott as a bug.
No, he's Mike TV.
Mike TV from Willy Wonka.
I'm not really sure what Scott
is. I don't know. Me either. I don't know Mike TV had a
TV thing.
That's hilarious.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, never dull moment.
Never a dull moment. That is right. So, with Mickey's Not So Scary Halloween Party, a lot of people are coming down just for that event. It is a big event. It's a fun event. One of the best events that Disney throws throughout the year. Year with ears. You agree?
Yeah, it's my favorite event of the whole year, actually.
Is it really?
Yeah, I think it has the best parade and the best fireworks all year long.
I'm going to disagree and go with Christmas, but I appreciate everybody loves Halloween.
Well, that would be why, John, we'll save you until December.
Okay.
Come back in December.
All right, thanks everyone. Have a good night.
Oh, my.
Oh, I love John.
So you're coming for the Mickey's Not So Scary Halloween Party. I'm right in that you can enter. Usually they let you in about 4 o'clock. Am I right?
Yeah, I think it's 4 o'clock you can go.
It's not guaranteed, but usually...
I think it says on there 4 o'clock.
Lets you... Well, officially the party starts at 7. So I think it's not like a guarantee that they will definitely let you in at 4. But if there's, you know, open capacity, you know, they haven't reached capacity, they'll let you go ahead and enter early. But what are, when you come in early like that, what are some of the things that you start to get involved with right away? The real stuff hasn't started to take place, you know, the big events that are on the pamphlet and all that. So tell me.
I think it's fun to throw out everybody that doesn't have a bracelet on. Oh. Because Disney don't do it, so you go, get out, it's my turn.
And they probably would if you were wearing that pirate costume. They'd be like, yeah, we'll be
I'm sorry, I use my superpowers for good.
Well, I just realized my shirt says, I heart pirates, and you have pirates of one.
Oh, I love you too.
It's a love fest here in Inner Mouse.
Can you feel
the love
tonight?
Back to Mickey's Not So Scary Halloween Party. So you go in, and pretty much, what's the first thing you see? A lot of people walking around in...
costumes.
Yeah, so let's talk about that.
Well, there's also a problem walking in at 4 o'clock as opposed to 8 when it's dark.
What's that?
The whole atmosphere is different, and I think Nicole's going to touch on that, but when you walk in at 8 o'clock and there's the projections of the witches, right, on Main Street, it's different than 4 o'clock when you see it in the day.
Okay.
But I think she knows more than I do about this.
All right, let's start from there then. What exactly is the difference between coming in at 4 o'clock and then coming in when the party officially starts at 7? What's the switch?
Well, this year I've gone twice, and I've gotten there both times just a little before 7. And, you know, it's been, like, dusk, and you see all the cool, like, little curtainy orange decorations they have. It's very fall-looking. There are many pumpkins already out, jack-o'-lanterns carved with cool things in them, like by Edie's. There's the ice cream cones, and...
My kids love those pumpkins.
They're so cute.
You can take a lot of time just looking at the details in those pumpkins, because depending on where they're placed, will determine what is carved in that pumpkin. Like you were saying, an ice cream cone in the pumpkin that sits on top of the ice cream store.
And there's like a ring by the jewelers, and just, they really put a lot of thought into that. And then, you know, there's a few more things, like they have like little scarecrows in the front of the mayor and, you know, like a chef in the very first hub there with the flagpole. And then, it's very decorated for fall, but it seems that there's such a quick transition. At 7 o'clock, they make an announcement, that the party is officially starting. The Haunted Mansion voice comes on. And then once it gets dark, it's really awesome. They have, like projections of shapes. Like they have ghosts that kind of like, you know, spook around Main Street, which I just love.
And yeah, I noticed that when we walked in because we didn't get there early this year. We came in after the party had already started, and you walk in, and one of the main things that you notice is it's considerably darker than it usually is mm-hmm. on Main Street. You know, normally Main Street is all lit up. Not so much at the Halloween party. And yeah, like you were saying, these images of ghosts floating across the Main Street buildings. I was like, ooh.
Yeah. Yeah, that's pretty cool. I like that part.
So if you do go in at 4, it's safe to say when it gets dark, go visit Main Street again just to get the atmosphere.
I would think so. There is a lot of atmosphere going on Main Street.
Yeah.
Is that? Do you think that's the primary location where things are happening? Or in other parts of the park, you know, what do you see in other parts of the park?
Well, I know the Haunted Mansion I like a lot better during Halloween.
Why so?
All the lighting is different. There's usually, and I say this because it's not every time, there's a lot of fog in the front. Some really good big industrial fog machines are having the front be all fog. The greenhouse on the end, you know the little greenhouse area?
Yeah.
It's all lit up with this ominous, shadowy glow that keeps walking around. And usually Carlotta or her sister, these are ghosts that live in the mansion, will come and sit on a bench on the front lawn, and they will converse with the people waiting online. Mm-hmm. Or the people exiting, as happened with, you were there with Chris, and they were singing to each other, and it went on for a half hour.
He proposed.
He did propose to her?
Yes.
Boy, he's desperate. He's going for dead women now. Wow. In any event, no, it was a lot of fun. It really was. Where she would say to me, where would you take me out on a date? And I said, the graveyard. I was bachelor number one, and Chris was bachelor number two. And she, they had said, okay, it's time for your sister to come out. And Carlotta said, no, I'm having too much fun. And that really was the cast member having too much fun with our crowd. She says, I will, I'm staying.
It's a true story.
And that was great to see because it let you know that the performer was actually having as much fun as the audience. And that's what makes it so special.
It really was.
It was a really cool experience.
She was funny.
And something else that happens that I noticed when we were there, you can't see it now because it's all walled off, but there's this whole foggy thing going on in the graveyard.
Oh, in the graveyard too?
Yes, and in that, you know, hilly area where Carlotta is. But when you're waiting in line and you pass the graveyard on the left, it's all foggy stuff, you know, around the tombstones.
Very cool.
Yeah. Is that, you know, does that pretty much cover it, what happens at the mansion?
Yeah, there's really nothing different inside, although later on I do have something from Matt Hatbox Fiend on Twitter. He gave me all the details on what happens during the night before Christmas change in Disneyland.
I'm sure
Heather will also give us some insight.
All right, we'll get to that in a minute. Well, Nicole, what else do they have going on that, you know, in the Magic Kingdom for this Halloween party?
Well, you mean the visual?
Yeah.
Well, Hatbox Fiend was saying earlier that there is a lot of purple and green and blue lighting, which there is. You know, usually, like you said, the park is well lit, and it just seems that it's still lit, but just with lots of fun colors now.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're first walking into Tomorrowland, and there's like that little like by Stitch and the left floor, there were like lights that were like blinking down, and then there were the different colored lights, and then there were the ghosts. There was a Mickey pumpkin, and it said Happy Halloween. So, I don't know. I just love that it appears so festive there. That's one of my favorite things about the party. Is it's the Magic Kingdom that you know and love, but it's just all decorated like you would do to your own house, or you know.
And you know, you'll have to tell me if you saw it because I actually didn't walk by this location when I went to the party this year, but I know in years past, they've actually had Cinderella's coach parked out in front of where what used to be the Skyway.
I saw somebody's photos with Cinderella's coach this
year. They use it as a photo pass opportunity where you can stand in front of Cinderella's coach with all kinds of pumpkins placed around it, and they've got a photo pass photographer that'll take your picture. It's in that stroller parking area.
Okay, cool.
In front of where the Skyway place in Fantasyland used to
be. Has Scott been to a Mickey's Not So Scary Halloween?
Yes, I have. It's been a couple of years, but I've been to one, and it was interesting because I was watching the parade on YouTube today. Thank you for the idea, Nicole. And it was interesting because it's pretty similar, but there are a few additions that I didn't see. So we'll get to that when I get to my portion. But yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I do remember there being blow up things like a huge Timon and Pumbaa near Pirates of the Caribbean. Is that still there?
Oh, that was...
Did they have that? I didn't see that.
The night that we went, it was there. I didn't see it this past time because I don't really remember, but it was like... it was representing the candy spot there.
Okay.
A huge one.
Right.
There's also just little games for kids to play throughout the whole park.
Oh, yeah.
My kids loved that. You know, stopping to toss, you know, bean bags or little hoops around witches' hats and... they had one that was kind of like a maze to see how fast you could run through it. And my kids had such a great time with that. And every time you completed a game, they gave you this little, like, not a certificate, but maybe a step down from what you would consider a certificate. Some kind of thing with a piece of paper to commemorate that they completed the beanbag toss or something like that on such and such a date. Yeah, it was really neat.
Fall festival to me.
The merchandise.
Talk about the merchandise.
I've mentioned this before, but this little ghost around my neck was $5, and I loved it because you probably can't see it unless we shut the lights. But he blinks. He does a whole bunch of red. You could choose if you want him to go in and out and whatever. $5. $5.
Yeah, but since you endorsed him last week, didn't you say that
they're sold out? Yes. I hope they get them back. Can you see this?
Ooh,
but wait,
my.
So now he's just holding. You could change what the lanyard is doing. You can change what the ghost is doing. Thank you very much, Keith. And I think they are sold out. But you know what? It makes sense because everything else is priced ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
For $5, you know, a dad or a mom could give $20 and give 4 children a gift.
John put his stamp of approval on those ghosts last week, and there was a run on the ghost cart.
And his name is Freddy because Carlotta came over to me and said, "Oh, is that Freddy?" And that was it. She named him. He's Freddy.
Love it. Well, one of the other big features of the Halloween party, obviously, is the costumes.
Love the costumes.
What types of things do you see when you walk into the park, costume-wise?
I saw Mr. and Mrs. Potato Head that was outrageous.
Did you really?
And also illegal, because their face was all covered. They were big potatoes walking through the park.
Oh, they had their face covered?
Completely.
That's one of the things, if you're going to go to Mickey's Not So Scary Halloween Party, they do have some restrictions on your costumes that you are supposed to respect. One would be that your eyes have to be completely visible, because they don't want you to not have clear vision and trip and fall and be a liability to them. You're also not allowed to wear anything that touches the ground. For the same reason, you don't want to have a, you know, superhero Incredibles type incident where the cape gets stuck when you're trying to get off of the people mover and then you get sucked down into the, you know...
Oh, my.
Mindy just said there was a box of crayon family.
That is cute.
Aww.
That's fun. That is
what
cool.
What color would you be?
Purple.
I would be red.
I would be pink and sparkly.
She'd be a glittery pink. Scott, what would you be?
I'd be blue.
All right. We could just do that.
We would have it all.
We're going to be crayons next year. I love it.
One of my favorite things about the costumes is seeing the families that dress up as stuff together.
Tell me about
it. Oh, like the Incredibles, yeah.
That's cute.
Yes.
I saw this huge green tail walking a couple weeks ago when we went. And I was like, what is this awkward costume? Turned around, it was Rex. And then next to them was Buttercup.
Oh, no.
And, you know, the whole Toy Story 3 gang. It was so cute. I loved it.
Oh, that is so adorable. And my friend Mary Jo, Mojo Disney on Twitter, I thought that she did the most creative thing. She dressed her kids up as Phineas and Ferb, and then she dressed up as Dr. Doofenshnickel, Schneeker.
Winnie the Platypus!
Schmertz! Doofenshmirtz! Doofenshmirtz! I remembered it! Dr. Doofenshmirtz. And I did not even recognize her at all. She called my name out, and I turned around. I looked dead at her and was like, who are you, and why are you saying my name?
That is so cute.
And she was like, it's me. And I'm like, oh, my gosh. It was so creative. It was homemade. You know, you don't go and buy Phineas and Ferb costumes. She totally completely put them together. Was awesome.
There are some people that will fool you, and you'll think, is that a Disney character? And then you'll realize it's not, but some people
their
get really good.
Their costumes are that good. We saw the evil Wicked Queen from Snow White, and I don't think that was a cast
really
member.
Good one. Yeah.
I don't think it was a cast member, was it?
She is out, usually, but you can tell, yeah. I think. Mostly.
There's no line in front of them, then they're probably just
they're just you know that you're not, if you are a guest, you're not allowed to sign or take pictures with other guests.
Oops, I took a picture with an alien this weekend.
Oh, you broke the rules. Because it's a licensing issue. You're not a real cast member with a legitimate Disney costume. And so you're not allowed to take pictures in case somebody were to mistake you for that.
Or do something inappropriate or something.
Yeah, something like that, you know? So,
makes sense.
Yeah. But there's a lot of things. You can't come in with pointy, sharp objects on your costume. Because you could, you know, hurt another guest. So there's a few things you got to be mindful of, but in general the costumes really are fantastic, and the creativity that some of these people put into these outfits, I mean, you realize
I have to say that
really
I also saw
time.
Some people like really decorated their wheelchair to the point of
what did you yeah. see
it when they stopped, it still looked like the wheel was going because they had the lights moving.
Oh, that's awesome.
And it was really, you know, it was obviously an elderly lady who took the time, or somebody did, to really decorate the wheel. There's just, you never know what you're going to see.
I love it. Cool. I love seeing people just completely invest themselves like that, you know?
Yeah.
And so you got your costume on, and what's one of the main things you want to do? You want to go get
candy.
You know, if you know the answer, why are you asking?
Candy, trick-or-treat okay. candy.
It's a rhetorical question, I guess. So you want to go get candy. Now, my family, we kind of skipped out on this part because of the special dietary issues and the need to try to minimize, basically eliminate sugar. So, but did you all go and get candy this year?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, she says.
I didn't get too much because of the group that I was in. We didn't stop too much, but I stole Snickers from other people's bags.
Snickers. So this is what I was going to ask. What exactly are in those candy barrels? Snickers, huh? That's good stuff.
I didn't find good stuff except for those Snickers. Other than that, I wasn't so happy. Except for the raisins. The raisins.
Don't be fooled, JL. You'll get a very large handful, and you'll be like, oh, Neckos.
Neckos?
Oh, Sixlets. Oh, one Snickers. No,
Moxie?
I don't.
They hand out Moxie.
I don't think the candy is particularly awesome, but I don't mind because then I don't eat it because I shouldn't be eating all the candy anyway.
Yeah.
But
well, and this is what they give you. I brought a little prop this week.
He's got a Moxie.
My fun little bag that they hand you at the door.
It.
So what you need to know is if you don't bring your own little candy container thing, they will supply you with one. They give out these cute little bags, and I don't know if they're the same every year, but this year they've got the Beauty and the Beast Diamond Edition advertised on one side and Toy Story 3 on the other side.
Last year it was Snow White.
And it's certainly, was it?
Yeah.
And
that,
it's certainly
that almost came out.
Adequate for getting a large amount of candy. Like, I would
oh, yeah.
be horrified, actually, if my children ever filled up this entire bag.
And don't be worried if you don't get it filled up, because on the way out, they will top you off.
Do they really?
Yeah.
So towards the end of the night.
Now, my kids have the special dietary needs, so we didn't get in any of the candy lines. But on the map, which I brought another prop, I brought my little map from the not-so-scary Halloween party this year. And so as I was browsing through it again today, I noticed that they have candy stops in every single land. At least one.
What's up with, do you notice Tomorrowland is like full of a lot more candy?
It's not Tomorrowland. You know what this is back here?
It
is that secret little pathway that goes behind the
that I
the
didn't
racetrack.
Know about because it's a secret? Wow.
It starts in Toontown, yes, and it walks behind the Indy Speedway, and it comes out next to Space Mountain. And during the Halloween party, they call it Alice and Mad Hatter's Treat Party.
Complete news to me.
And you just walk down that path and you hit, let's see, let's count them. 1, 2, 3 candy spots just on that one path. And you haven't walked back there? It's so cute,
John.
That
is cool.
It's really
they have it decorated with all Alice in Wonderland stuff. So, and everyone knows how I feel about Alice in Wonderland. So they've got, you know, the red cards and the black cards and cutouts of trees with the red roses and the white roses and the flower bed.
Stuart is mentioning something that I think you did about going to the cast members to find something that your kids will eat.
Well, we didn't realize it. You guys were telling me that you saw candy barrels that just had raisins.
Just raisins.
So you could get in a candy line or you could get in a raisin line. Am I right?
They didn't let us know that ahead of time.
I didn't know that.
But it did exist.
So my children did not get in any line because I thought that the end result would be something that would, you know, hurt them. But what we did instead was we went to guest relations at the end of the evening and we said, you know, my kids can't have, you know, the candy. Is there any type of alternative? And the guy at guest relations was awesome. He says to me, would you like some? He said, well, first let me see if we have any raisins. I was like, raisins are perfect. But it was the end of the night and he was out of raisins. So then he said, well, let me ask you this. Would you like something that's sugar-free or gluten-free? Which I thought was really awesome. Wow. That they were offering things for that purpose, and I actually had a hard time deciding because my kids really can't have sugar, and at the same time, gluten also does some damage to them. But picking the lesser of two evils, I said, okay, I guess we'll go with sugar-free. So he wrote me, because I have three children, he wrote me a gift certificate for $50 worth of sugar-free candy to take to the confectionery on the other side of Main Street.
$50.
No way.
Yes, he did.
I am That's so awesome. Going to have an issue next time. No, I'm kidding. That is great.
Wow. Now, the problem was it was at the end of the party and the confectionery was closed. So I couldn't get in there, but I did rap on the door and they came. Why are you laughing?
Because I'm thinking rap on a table. It's time to respond. Send her some candy from somewhere. Okay.
So, you know, I rapped on the door and they came to the door and I said, I've got these gift certificates that I'm supposed to send because my kids can't have candy. I said, I realize that you're closed. I live nearby. I'm local. Is it okay if I come back on another day and redeem this? I don't see any expiration. They said, no, it's fine. Just come back whenever and you can use it then. So I still have to go back and I still have to go back and get this, you know, sugar-free candy. But what a cool thing. So people That's out awesome. There with issues.
That really is great.
There are some alternatives for you.
And I will tell you, the sugar-free gummy bears from the confectionery are really better than the regular gummy bears.
Really?
I don't know why.
Surprise, surprise. Okay,
they taste fruitier. They're softer. I like them.
Awesome. Well, one of the main events of the evening is the Boo to You Parade. Which, from what I've heard from everyone else, that this is the best parade of the year.
Christmas.
For sure.
You like the Christmas one better?
Yeah, but nobody right. else does. Again, nobody else
back,
does.
Come back in December. Okay. We'll talk to you in December.
All right, thank you. Good night, everyone.
All right, so the Boo to You Parade. Now, Scott, I know that you have particular interest in this parade. What is it exactly? Can you tell us, like, what's the progression, you know, costumes, characters, music, and so on and so forth, and what is it that stands out to you?
Well, first off, I can't take myself seriously in my TV glasses, so. And wow, I can see again. Wow, okay, great. Well, first off, the parade starts in Frontierland and ends in Town Square. And I give them this tip in the pre-show. If you stay for the second parade, it actually is a lot less crowded. So that's just a little tip for you. So if you have young kids, usually you want to go to the first one. If you're a little bit older, you want to stay for the second one. The most awesome thing for me when I first saw it, because I didn't know this was going to happen, and we had a good spot, was seeing the Headless Horseman come running down right at the beginning of the show. He comes down through, he trots down through with, you know, carrying the pumpkin and everything. It's really amazing to see. And the horse is huge. And
it's the only time you can see him, right? The only time in the whole year that he ever appears, is that correct?
Yeah, exactly. And I'm pretty sure that NDK49 knows him personally, being a Van Tassel and
she's
all.
A Van Tassel. So
she really is a Van Tassel.
You know that's really got to be, like, the most dangerous job in Disney of the year, riding that horse without a head.
Yeah, you can't see it all. And whatever,
and you're only holding on with one hand?
I think it was last year or the year before that I was telling you he fell.
Ugh.
Yeah.
I just, poor guy. I never thought I'd feel sorry for the Headless Horseman.
But, you know, one of my favorite things throughout is the homage that they give to the Haunted Mansion. And they really bring all the characters to life out there. And I said to you guys the other day, one of my favorites was the Grave Diggers, and they come out with their shovels, and they have a whole choreographed dance, and they run these shovels across the macadam, and it creates sparks. It's so cool. And it goes along with the music really well. One of the things that kind of struck me really cool was the graveyard. The caretaker comes out with the dog from the graveyard scene.
That's cool.
Which I thought that was just so awesome. And the dog was really cool. He was going around sniffing all the kids, and the kids were petting them and everything. And also the ballroom dancers were amazing. The costumes were amazing. And Nicole, what did you think of that?
They're my favorite. I was actually watching the dance and maybe learning it in my bedroom today. And I just love that part because I'm a big person with, like, being a theater major and stuff. I love dancing that has costumes that have stuff that hang off of them and that are affected by your movement. And they're, like, you know, the zombie-esque, and they have the big updos the girls do, and the guys, like, whip the girls into a back bend, and their big costumes, like,
whoosh. It's all very flowing. And something else I noticed was they all kind of do this, I don't even know how to describe it with their body, but, like, a head tilt or something where it's a little bit off, and you feel like their body parts might come off at any time. You know, they're just, like, a little bit discombobulated, if for lack of a better word.
It's very, like, zombie-esque. They, like, kind of...
It's rather thrillerish.
Yes, it is, like, yeah.
Yeah, but in a ballroom sense.
In a Haunted Mansion ballroom way.
Yeah.
Love it. Those are my favorite parts.
Yeah. No, I'm just agreeing. By the way, does anybody else cringe when the gravediggers make the sparks? Because I'm like, because they're ruining Main Street.
What do you mean they're ruining?
When the shovels smash on Main Street and they spin around and make sparks, I cringe that they're ruining Main Street. I love it. No, don't get me wrong. I love it. But part of me is like, someone has to fix the cement next week.
Well, John, your admission ticket helped pay for the resurfacing of the street, so it's okay.
That's no joke. Those tickets are a little bit on the pricey side.
Seriously.
Nobody else thought about the damage at all? I'm not the only one? Okay, all right.
They come out and repave the road every night.
Okay.
Well, I've got some questions for you guys as we go through my list, because, you know, that's just the way I am. But one of the things, Madame Leota has a float. And I don't remember seeing this before. I saw it today on the video. It's small. But is that new this year, or is it new a couple years ago, or did I just miss it when I saw it?
I think you missed it. I think it's been there.
Okay.
I remember seeing
that. That was cool.
Yeah, I like that too.
Yeah, okay, so Nicole, you've got my first question.
Ooh.
This is going to be a tough one. And John, do not help her.
Shut it, pirate.
All right. Within the parade, on this one awesome float, we have the three hitchhiking ghosts. Nicole, name the three hitchhiking ghosts.
I just found this out this weekend. I have to remember. Phineas, Ezra, and somebody else. I can't remember his name. John, I have been wanting to know that for so long, and somebody just randomly was like, yeah, when Ezra, Gus, and Phineas come out, I was like, wait, are those the hitchhiking ghosts? Like, I'm so excited to know that, so I almost got it, but...
I had no idea.
You did pretty good.
Isn't that exciting?
Phineas, Ezra, and Gus. Okay.
I wish I knew something new. Who.
Charles is crying.
Why is it sad?
I don't know why he thinks it's that. Maybe just that you didn't know? I don't know. One of the cool things that I liked on it, too, is they really bring back, they do certainly current characters. They do characters from the park, like Haunted Mansion. But they also bring back some characters from old Disney classics. And one of the things I liked seeing was the donkeys from Pinocchio.
Yeah.
And that was pretty cool when I saw those the first time. And also the crocodile from Peter Pan.
Yeah,
I love that float. That is an awesome float.
Yep. And it has the tick-tock sound when it comes by.
Yep.
Yes, it does. That, cool. Yes, it does.
It's like that really slow tick-tock.
By the way, the reason Charles was sad is that he couldn't stay for the whole show. That's a great reason to be sad.
Did you
notice that they have Pain and Panic in the parade as well?
Yeah.
Who's that?
From Hercules.
That's one of my questions for you, JL.
Oh, look how good I am. I answered before you even asked it.
You are on it. You're like... It's like we're attached by the...
She's like Madame Leota. She knows the question.
Yeah. The Pain and Panic, they are shown in the parade, and they've been there for a long time. As far as you know, is this the only time you get to see Pain and Panic in a Disney park?
Are you talking about, like, in a Disney park worldwide?
Okay, let's just say, let's keep it in Walt Disney World. Why don't we say that?
Well, as far as I know, yes, but that doesn't mean that I'm correct.
Oh, she just answered two ways.
Well, you asked me as far as I know. So as far as I know, yes, but...
Okay.
My girl Amy Beth Combs is helping me out in the chat room. She says that they were in a parade at the Hollywood Studios.
Correct.
You go, girl Amy.
Bam.
And maybe the chat room, they can help us out, but I haven't seen them on anything else except for that parade and this parade.
My girl's got my back.
Oh, yeah, she rocked. She rocked.
Do I have a question, Scott? Because I'm scared.
Yes, you do.
I'm scared because he's going to give me a hard one that I'm not going to know. I know, Scott.
Well, I definitely, it's not a Haunted Mansion question. I can tell you that because it wouldn't be fair because you know too much about Haunted Mansion. One thing, I don't know if you guys feel this way, but when the hyenas come out in the parade, that they just freak me out.
They scare me.
They're weird looking.
I got freaked out. I had a cringe. I was sitting on the curb, and one ran over to me, and I had to close my eyes.
Yeah. They're just freaky. So if you haven't seen this parade, look for the hyenas. They'll really creep you out. You know, when I saw it before, they had the Pirates of the Caribbean, but I saw in the video today that they now have Jack Sparrow on top of the parade float, and they have Barbossa walking around and kind of greeting people, which I thought was really cool, as well as the people from the ride, too. Do you know when that switched? Does anybody know?
This is my first year, so I wouldn't know.
I don't know. I haven't watched that parade that much.
I do know he got, you know, major applause when he went by.
Yes. He was
big hit. Mm-hmm.
Definitely. Okay, John, here's your question.
Oh, boy.
This is going to be a good one. In the parade, we have Winnie the Pooh, and we have all the characters from the Many Adventures of Winnie the Pooh. What was Eeyore dressed as?
I know.
Well, I didn't see the parade this year. But I remember Eeyore being dressed as another Pooh character, I believe.
No.
Hold on. Can you give me a hint?
I can't remember.
Okay, John. He was a
clown.
And absolutely no prompting. Great job, John.
That was JL. She
you are so good.
Thank you, JL.
John, you're amazing.
JL, okay, I did not know that he was a clown.
I had to give you a tough one. So here's a question for everybody. In the parade for Mickey's Not So Scary Halloween Party, in the parade, how are the floats powered?
By apple juice.
Battery.
I'm waiting to see some...
Keith says some pixie dust.
Pixie dust, correct. By magic, correct.
By spectrum does anybody magic. Know?
Vegetable oil, JL said. No, I'm kidding. No,
I said yes, I remember. Don't make me wallow in that.
Stop.
There are bicyclists pedaling
I think they're battery operated.
It's by spectrum magic.
Okay, here's what I found out. Okay, I did some serious searching on this, and I found out, obviously, the spectrum magic ones, all of the cars are run by about 8 batteries. And that's to run the lights, the syncing system with the sound, and the motorized vehicles themselves. So, but I couldn't find anything on this specific parade, so I'm assuming they are the same, and I'm looking for some correction from somebody. So if anybody's hearing this afterward, email me at scott@innermouse.com and let me know.
It's 3 AAAs. I'm
three
kidding.
AAA batteries.
No, I do believe they are still battery operated the same, Scott.
I would think so as well.
I would think so, too. The vehicles are pretty impressive because even the alligator from Peter Pan has amazing motion, the way he can spin and turn and everything. And I think it's the same type of vehicle.
It really is.
That they use in Spectrum Magic. So. And that's what I got. I love the parade. When I saw it, I stayed for both showings of it because I thought it was so awesome and the fireworks. So.
Well, for everybody watching, if you want to go to thedisneydrivenlife.com, our very own Mark Lorenzo, NDD number 40, submitted us some video footage from the Boo to You parade just this last year, 2010. It's on the site right now. So just scroll on down the page and you can have, you know, a little snippet of the video from this year at Walt Disney World. Also in the show notes, we mentioned this last week, but I'll put it in the show notes again for this week. Martin's Vids has an incredible video of not only the Boo to You parade, but, you know, just the Mickey's Not So Scary Halloween party in general for last year, 2009. I will warn you, it's very lengthy. It has everything on it. So, you know, go and check it out. My kids watched it for a very long time today, but it was so good it kept their attention.
If they stay for the after party, it's possible that Keith may be able to play it for them.
Awesome. That would be incredible. Then we can all watch the Boo to You parade.
Stick around after the party. We can watch Boo.
Ooh, props. Look at that. Okay.
It's woman so, power going on here.
The next thing, you know, that happened. The next...
Hey, man. How you doing, man?
I only drink Moxie, man.
For all of the people listening and not watching, Scott has just done a very spontaneous costume change on us and caught us completely off guard.
He's got a Rasta wig or something.
He is Rastaman. He went from being a bug to being Rastaman. Okay. So, Happy Hallowishes is the fireworks show.
That's cool.
Let's talk about that. Now, how is this different from other fireworks shows?
Well, it's narrated by the boogeyman from...
Oogie Boogie?
Oogie Boogie.
From Nightmare Before Christmas?
Yes. And one of the features that they have that I really enjoy is they, up on the upper right corner of the castle, they'll do like a ding-dong sound, and they'll flash a little light there, and it'll be like
as
a new villain.
Ding-dong.
It's so cool. And then he's like, let's see who's here now. And then it's great. And they are perimeter fireworks at some points.
But
Their
perimeter fireworks, that is the best perimeter fireworks. Sometimes when they do perimeter, you get a couple of booms. This is a real... orchestration in each area of the perimeter, I will say, wowed me.
It is completely amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I mean, and one of the things that stood out to me that I've noticed that in general, the colors of the fireworks are different.
There was an a jellyfish firework when Ursula was out.
Oh, yes,
right?
Yes.
They're the best.
Oh!
Yeah, it's like a half blue and then the red feet coming down or something, yeah.
I missed that.
It's
didn't
great.
Pay attention close enough. Man, now I need to go back. But it's really heavy on greens and purples and oranges.
Yeah.
Don't you agree?
I definitely do.
Very heavy on those colors.
I love what they do to the castle as well. I mean, in some of the fireworks shows, it'll, like, you know, fade out to different colors. Or they'll do, like, for wishes, they have the sorcerer colors. And they have, like, the rainbow colors. For this, I feel like the castle is just changing all the time. And just color and craziness and sparkle and... sparkle, and just so fun. I love what they do to the castle for this.
Am I better now, John?
Okay,
I'm a lop-eared bunny. So, okay, the story. What is the story of the fireworks? Now, we know wishes is all, you know, theming around, you know, making your dreams come true, and Summer Nightastic was this whole thing about people attacking the castle, or, you know...
Well, I think the story for this is kind of just... Well, they take music, like, they take Poor Unfortunate Souls, and they take, It's Halloween from This Is Halloween. They take that.
Nightmare Before Christmas.
And they put, like, these R&B type or, you know, different, or pop style singers to do them.
Mm-hmm.
And, do you think there's really a story? I think it's more just about... kind of like
I
a
think
party
the door thing
and
is
like,
the story.
Yeah,
like people visiting, villains visiting,
the villains entering and
trick or treating,
showing up for the show. Yeah, it's very
like trick or treating,
very villain oriented.
Yeah,
yeah. So very fun. Anything else you think that we needed to cover about that?
We might want to find out from Disney Big Sis what happens in Disneyland and how that's different.
Not yet.
Oh, okay.
We have a few more things to cover.
Not yet.
Not yet.
You asked what was next. I thought that was next. I don't know what next. I gotta just sit here.
Let me do my job. All right. Well, if you think that that's it, as far
as I don't know too much else about the fireworks.
Well, where would be the best location to watch these fireworks?
I definitely believe from the beginning of Main Street for me is the best. Not really too close. And not too far up, but right in the middle of Main Street, I think, would
maybe
be
like in that section where the hub meets
yes.
the long corridor.
Yes. You got it. Right next to Casey's. You got it.
Mine's at the end of that, like in the hub. That's where we were last
okay.
time.
Yeah. In the hub.
Well, I know for wishes
on
it could be
far
too close.
Side
so
of the hub.
I like it when you, the perimeter fireworks are really perimetering.
Right.
You.
Mm-hmm. I think that's fine. Yep. Well, did you all ever happen to stop in at one of their character dance parties?
Yes.
I know that Nicole did because I haven't heard, stopped hearing about the Villains Mix and Mingle and all that stuff.
Well, there are two dance parties, not the Villains Mix and Mingle show, but the dance parties. Mm-hmm. One at Stitch's Soundstage in Tomorrowland, and one in the what used to be the Diamond Horseshoe Review in Frontierland. Which one did you stop in on?
The first party I went to 2 weeks ago, I went to the one in Tomorrowland.
Okay.
They played the Cupid Shuffle, and I was dressed up as Cupid, and I heard it and went, I have to dance, and ran over. Rora and I went and did it. And then this past time, there's also a candy spot in the Diamond Horseshoe, so I went in there and got candy and boogied across to the candy as they played the Monster Mash and then skedaddled off.
Now, the main feature of these things is they have characters dancing that whoever goes to these events can get jiggy with Goofy or
Woody.
Or Woody or Donald or whoever happens to be there. Now, when we went with my kids, we went to the one that is in the Diamond Horseshoe Review building. And there was Goofy and Donald. Were there different characters at the Stitch one?
The Stitch one... on the spot. I don't remember. I think it was
she was
Goofy.
Too wrapped up in her own little jiggy dance.
Little sugar high going on there.
Dale.
Okay.
I'm saying. I don't remember exactly, but was Woody there with Jesse and Bullseye when you went to the Diamond Horseshoe?
Woody was there.
Okay.
Woody was there. I don't remember Jesse being there, not on the night that we were, and at the time we were. We went really late. But it was the funnest little thing. They've got these DJs cool. there with this hopping music, and my kids were loving it. I confess I got out there and I did a little dancing too, you know, couldn't help it. So, and it's so much fun to be in that environment and just feeling like you can just totally not be embarrassed. I mean, everybody already looks ridiculous in costumes. Yeah. Or maybe it's because you're in a costume and you're kind of disguised. You can just get out there and, you know, not feel foolish.
Yeah.
And I had the greatest time with my kids. It was so much fun. And you should have seen Ellie. She kept trying to kind of, you know, get in with the characters, you know, and kind of shimmy her way over and kind of get in between whoever was dancing with, you know, Donald at the time. She'd kind of dance in between them like, all right, here I am. It's me. It's all about me. So it was really, really funny. Her doing her little robot.
I'm sorry that I missed this. Over by the Tomorrowland area where they always do the dancing, was there a whole thing going on there too?
Yeah, that's where one of the dance parties
okay,
are.
Cool.
So you got to go.
I do have to go. I'm going to go back, I think, on the 28th.
You can do the cha-cha slide.
I want to go again, too.
I don't know about the cha-cha slide, but I'll try.
How low can you go? Can you go down low?
I hurt people if they say slide to the left and I go to the right, so I just try to... I don't want to hurt people.
I think you're all good. So that's definitely, especially if you have kids, I am highly, highly recommending those dance parties. It's something that little kids don't really get to do too often. It's not like they go out to clubs. So this is, you know, the 7-year-old version of a club, you know, and it's a happening thing. It's like a little mini person rave or something.
That's funny.
So
they're trading candy in the back. I got some Snickers. I've got some Skittles.
So yeah. All right. Well, then there's the stage show. The Dillons. Disney Villains Mix and Mingle. Now, I totally skipped this thing because I was going on rides and going to dance parties and, you know, seeing people in their costumes and meetups and the parade. So I didn't do it. What am I missing here? What happens?
Well, I went this past Sunday, and it was like later in the night, and I really wanted to see it. We got a nice seat right in front. I was all excited. And then, you know, it starts, and Maleficent is kind of the host of it. She comes out, and then there were, like, some male dancers that came out that had on attire, which I thought was questionable to be appropriate. It was like a fishnet shirt, but moving on. Then they did some dancing. Like, they did, like, a little roll across the stage, and were, like, really, like, I don't know. I was a little, not offended, but it just wasn't something I would go see again because I felt like the male and female dancers weren't less than Disney-esque. It didn't seem fun and Halloween-y to me. It seemed like maybe a little seductive almost. But it's a cute show. The effects are cool. The villains come out, which is, you know, it's exciting because you don't get to see the villains as much as the other characters.
Are the villains so in your face that it would be something that would maybe freak out some kids?
Well, it's on the stage in front of the castle. And when I was there, a lot of people were just sitting right down in front. So it wasn't, you know, real scary. I think they're up there on the stage, so I think you'd be okay. They do about a 7 or 8 minute show, and then they actually come down and take pictures, and that's the mingle part.
Okay.
And so if you had little ones that were going to be scared, that would be the time to go. But okay. Like I said, there was like quite a line for the Wicked Queen. It's, you know.
Okay.
So
but you're not recommending this maybe for little kids or families that, you know, are maybe sensitive to certain types of dancing and certain types of dress.
I would definitely say so.
It's definitely not G, it would be PG.
I would say a little PG, yeah.
Okay.
I think it's safe also to say Nicole's not really shocked about anything too much, so if she thought it was a little risque, it probably was.
All right, so moms and dads, just be forewarned, before you watch the Disney villains mix and mingle, maybe you want to check it out before you stand there with their kids in case it's something that you would feel is not very well suited for your family. Would you say it's worth the time if it's somebody who's not offended by those types of things?
It's definitely about dancing. The beginning, there's just a lot of dancing. But if you want to meet the villains, I think this is a really cool time to do it. It's right in front of the castle, and, you know, it's Halloween. You might want pictures of the villains. I think it's a cool thing to do. So I would go just for the pictures alone if you don't think it would be too much for you.
Now, did you get any pictures with the villains? Did you have interaction with them?
No, the lines got real long real fast because they kind of do the little show, and then they say, no, we're coming to mingle with you. And they come down, and everyone just kind of goes, boop, into a line, and, you know, they're about 20 people long or so.
I guess I was just kind of wondering. I know that when they have the characters really get into their parts. And with a villain, I would think that could be maybe a little bit intimidating if you have, you know, Cruella de Vil, you know, getting all yucky and evil in your face and pulling out dead puppies or something.
Well, I've seen in the show she did it, and I've seen her in the park and on the parade. Maleficent will just kind of do like a staring thing and like watch you as you go by. So I think they'll do it to an extent, and, you know, I don't think they would do like overdo it with small children. You know, I think they probably. What's so funny?
I just pictured Krull pulling out the dead puppies, and I can't do it. I'm sorry.
All right, so maybe she doesn't pull out dead puppies, but...
After she just did a risque dance, she's pulled out dead puppies, and then you said, do they get into their parts? And I can't sit here any longer and not react. I try. I really try.
What kind of dog do you have, little girl?
Hey, JL.
We had a good question
from Tim on the chat room.
Yes.
And he was saying, you know, I don't think he's been there before, and he was asking about, is it mainly just a party? Is there some rides? What exactly is the thing? And, you know, you guys can correct me if I'm wrong, but there are little parties around. There's trick-or-treating. And certain rides are open. Not all rides are open, but certain rides are open. Of course, Haunted Mansion, Pirates of the Caribbean. I think Space Mountain's open. So there are some rides open, but not everything's open. It's more about a party kind of atmosphere. Am I correct in that?
Yeah, not every ride, but I would say most.
Most of
the rides are open. So, you know, I missed actually a lot of stuff because we were still going on rides. What is not open once the party officially starts are the table service restaurants. Mm. It's counter service and kiosks, pretty much. Let me check my little map, but that's what I'm pretty sure.
I think the only things that might be closed are like the Tiki Room, I think, is closed.
Yeah, the Carousel of Progress is closed. I would say most of the rides are open, but it is more of like a thing to go with your friends and kind of enjoy the trick-or-treating and have fun getting dressed up. It is more so like a party to enjoy the atmosphere.
Was Jungle Cruise open? I would love them to haunt that up a little bit. That would be a great way.
Oh, that would be a fantastic one.
Wouldn't that be awesome to haunt up the Jungle Cruise at night?
Jungle Cruise was not open.
Okay.
In Adventureland, the only ones that were open were Swiss Family Treehouse, which they could do something cool with that if they wanted to. Pirates of the Caribbean and the Magic Carpets of Aladdin. So, yeah. Well, now, character appearances, we kind of got into that a little bit. The characters are different. You see a lot of characters that you don't normally see in the parks, mainly villains. And then the characters that you do see are all dressed up in Halloween costumes.
Yes. There's a really cute Donald and Daisy in front of Toontown, and Daisy's a princess, and Donald is a pumpkin, I think. It's cute.
Very cute. Hey, so who do you like to see?
The hag I thought was great. The hag from Snow White with her apple. That's very rare that you see her.
Where did you see her?
She was right in front of Mrs. Potts' cupboard.
Okay.
By, of course, from Dumbo.
Okay.
And one year, not this year, I saw Sora. Sora, S-O-R-A, is one of the big characters from the Kingdom Hearts video game.
Oh, wow.
And I think Katie saw him once, she mentioned. But let me tell you, the Sora character looked fantastic. Like, no expense was spared on this character.
Was it hologram Sora, or was it just Sora Sora?
No, it was Sora Sora with something called the Keyblade, which is what they used to fight.
Okay.
And they were in front of the laugh floor. And I don't know if they were there this year. Did anybody see Kingdom Hearts this year at all? Because they're coming back again, the game, but the characters were wonderful. And I've seen a lot more villains. You know who I saw? The blue guy from Hercules. What's his name? The bad guy.
Oh, Hades.
Hades. Wait, I haven't seen him until Halloween.
Awesome.
That was pretty cool.
I missed that. Now, we do have a correction to make because I believe it was last week we told you all that Pete was there in Mickey's Toontown Fair, but that ended up being a falsehood.
Being turned up being an actual guest who had probably a better Pete costume than I did.
It was a guest in the park that had a really rockin' Pete costume. And
I'm
so
sad because I want the real Pete.
Somebody tricked John. He thought that Pete had appeared.
Yes.
And it really wasn't. So we did want to make that correction. Don't expect to find Pete. He won't be by Pete's garage.
I'm hoping somebody says, no, there really is a real Pete, because that would be very cool.
Maybe John will draw.
The fact that there's a Clara Cluck.
Say it again?
I thought Scott just said something. Go ahead, Scott.
I said, John, you will always be my favorite Pete character.
Aw, thank you. The fact that there's a Clara, what is it, Clara Cluck or them? The fact that they're there tells me that there should...
Clara Cow.
Clara Bell.
Somebody, yes, Clara Bell.
That there should be a Pete.
Somebody asked before who was the chicken in the parade. I don't remember.
She's definitely from a cartoon.
But oh, the big chicken, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, they're from movie about the farm, that bad Disney movie.
Home on the Range.
No, it wasn't Home on the Range. She's older than that.
Range. Yeah.
She's like from the old Disney cartoons, I think.
Was it Chicken Little?
Nope.
No.
Okay.
Old Disney cartoons, like 90s.
The sky is falling.
Yeah. Oh, like 90s.
I Am Pumpkin Glee says Clara Cluck.
Clara Cluck.
Yeah, Clara I thought she Cluck. Was in like a Disney classic Disney cartoon. So, all right. Now, we've all been talking about Walt Disney World, but Disneyland does something different than what Disney World does. It's not the same party. What is the difference? And should we prefer to go to Disneyland over Disney World, or does it matter? Or are they, you know, comparing apples and oranges? Tell me the story.
Well, Matt Hatbox Fiend gave me stuff on the Haunted Mansion, but I think before we even get to that, we invited Disney Big Sis Heather, who is from the
West Coast. She lives in
Arizona. And the show that she does is Mr. Frank's Wild Ride.
Mm-hmm.
And Heather, can you tell us a little bit about what is different in the Christmas party, assuming they even have one in Disneyland?
Not Christmas.
Halloween.
John
wow.
is just...
I love wow. the Christmas party.
He so will not get off of that Christmas party.
Heather, the Halloween
we're
party.
We're Halloween here tonight, John.
Heather's gone. She probably said, nah, they're not talking. Let me get up what I got from Matt until she gets here. But, okay, if anybody knows The Nightmare Before Christmas, the Haunted Mansion in Disneyland gets a complete makeover. I'm not talking about a couple of signs. They get audio animatronics, and it becomes a Tim Burton Nightmare Before Christmas makeover.
Oh, cool.
And I hate to read, but this is the only way to remember all that Matt sent me. He says, around this time of year in Disneyland, the Haunted Mansion welcomes in-home spooktacular guests for the holidays, and Nightmare Before Christmas. As you walk up to the mansion, you'll notice the scarecrow waiting outside, pumpkins, candles galore, adorning the haunted mansion's facade. Even the ghost horse and the hearse are decorated.
Wow.
If you look up to the roof, you'll see Jack's sleigh with old names hanging off of it. As you enter the stretching room, the pictures of the corruptible mortals are now stained glass pictures. All ribbons and Tim Burton-esque skulls everywhere. As you board your sleigh, so I'm assuming that they decorate the doom buggies, and Matt can tell me if this is correct.
It does. It sounds like they are not really doom buggies anymore.
The background is one giant Christmas card wishing you a merry or scary Christmas. The Christmas characters are revealed like a giant scary advent calendar. If you look at the moon, you'll see Jack and some witches fly by. Oogie Boogie makes an appearance.
Ooh.
The endless hall where the floating candelabra is, you'll see Zero the ghost.
Oh!
The ghost dog, I meant to say. As you enter the conservatory, there's a man-eating wreath waiting for you. The guy in the casket, you know the guy? Let me out. He's just now a gift waiting to be opened. The grand ballroom is a giant Christmas party with all your favorite haunts, plus a giant Christmas tree instead of a cake. There's a gingerbread haunted mansion, which I think is really awesome.
Yum.
A gingerbread haunted mansion with a zombie gingerbread man and a Jack Skellington cookie jumping out from the back.
This is all in the ballroom room?
Well, no, that's the ballroom scene, yep.
Okay.
Then as you go into the seance circle, there's floating candles. Leota floats, obviously. She recites instead of the same reciting. This is very interesting.
Instead of
this regular seance, the 13 Days of Christmas. Leota is portrayed by Leota Toombs' daughter, Kim Irvine, who is an Imagineer just like her mom. So I think that's a great way to pay homage to that attraction.
That is awesome.
It really is.
That's special.
Jack himself is in the graveyard with Zero the dog, where the caretaker and Bones used to be.
Cool.
And everything is snow-covered with the jack-o'-lanterns, five of which the jack-o'-lanterns sing instead of the busts.
Oh.
So there's jack-o'-lanterns singing instead of there. And, I mean, it's a complete makeover. Now, the problem is if they did want to bring it here, some people would actually be upset.
Not me. I'm all for it. Disney, bring it.
As long as I know they're going to change it back after Halloween,
yeah,
I'd be all for it.
I'm totally cool with that. That seasonal stuff, that just is awesome. Sounds really, really great.
I think Keith was saying before in the chat that Disneyland is more, the people that go there are more locals.
Mm-hmm.
They have, like, way more annual pass holders than Disney World does. So, you know, it would alter a lot of people's experiences who are coming here for their,
for their only trip.
Yeah.
I heard that too. I'm sure it's also a big budget thing. Heather, are you there? Did she send us any other? Was she confirming or anything?
Yeah, she was kind of confirming what you guys were talking about. A couple of people said that the locals there in Disneyland, some of them don't like the overlay. Everybody was talking about there's an overlay that's happening, I believe, in Space Mountain that happens digitally. I guess it's Ghosts in Space. I've never seen it. I don't know what it is. Can anybody help me out as to what that's called and what it is exactly on the chat room? Ghost Galaxy, it's called. So it's an overlay in Space Mountain.
You know, I forgot. I looked this up last year. I think it was Disneyland Japan has, like, a huge zombie, like, either it's their Christmas party or no, aliens. Aliens is what
that's
it was.
That's in Hong Kong.
Hong Kong, okay. I saw that on the website.
Yeah,
like,
it's like a big spaceship lands on Space Mountain or something, and the whole thing, well, the whole theme of the park, actually, is that the park has been invaded by aliens, and it's really creepy. Like, not the nice aliens, like Independence Day aliens.
It looked scary.
Yeah.
Wow.
This is where?
In Hong Kong.
Wow.
Yeah, like creepy, stuff. Like, my kids probably would not want to go.
Me either.
I don't know if I would.
I'd want to go. I would want to go.
Creepy.
As long as they don't touch me. You know.
Welcome, we hope you get abducted today.
Well, you know. So, is there anything else that we need to know?
That's really what I know from the Haunted Mansion. I'm still would love to find out from Heather. Is there a Halloween party in Disneyland?
Yeah, Mickey's Not So Scary Halloween Party.
It's the same type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. But they
mention, she said it's quite a bit different, is what she said, than the one in Florida. One of the comments made by, and I don't remember who said it, and I apologize, but somebody said that Leota's face actually floats in a Christmas ball instead of in the
glow. Love it.
That was Kimber Knight that said that.
Well, so sounds like it's a toss-up.
Matt's saying that the Blu-ray from Nightmare Before Christmas has a ride-through of the Holiday Layover. That would be awesome.
All right, somebody's got to buy it, and I have to watch it. Really, really want to see that.
I want to see it, too.
And Heather says the fireworks are actually better at Disneyland. I don't know, Heather. Fireworks were really amazing.
Zero does fly? I was joking about that this weekend. She has been to both.
Really? So she knows. She knows.
She's been to both.
She said Zero flies.
Zero flies. That would be really awesome to see Zero the dog come out of the castle.
I was joking with someone about that this
weekend. That would be really, really awesome.
I didn't know that really happened.
So that's kind of the event thing that goes on at Disney parks. As a neurotic Disney person living the Disney-driven life, it certainly is an event that you really want to try to aim to get at some point in your life. Take lots of pictures. It's a fun, memorable event. Great time for families. It's probably best if you can go during the week rather than on a weekend. And the further away you get from Halloween, like if you go at the beginning of October, the less crowded it will be as well.
And the further you'll be towards Christmas! Excuse me. I'm sorry, I had a sneeze.
I'm excited to see Christmas now, John. I'm going to be like, show it to me. What's better than Halloween
decorations? In Disney
decorations?
Is very special.
Yeah.
I'm sure it will.
I mean, it's chills galore up my spine, for real.
All right, the floor will be yours at Christmas time, John.
Yay.
Are you going to dress up as Santa for us?
Yes, I probably will.
I love it.
I will do that.
We can be elves.
Oh, we need to do this.
We should we're going to do that.
All right, so already in our minds, we're going to December. So with that, we will be moving on to our shout-outs for the week. In the NDP community this week, we're shouting out to NDD number 17, Matt W. in Florida.
Hi, Matt!
NDD number 18, Dean P. in Minnesota.
Hi, Matt.
Matt and Dean, hello! NDGM number 19, Susan M. in Ohio. Hi, Susan.
Matt, Dean, and Susan. Oh, I thought we were just adding them.
NDI number 19, Eric E. in Connecticut. Hi, Eric. NDI number 20, Becca B. in England. Hi, Becca. NDK number 19, Alexis W. in Florida. Hi, Alexis. NDK number 20, Chloe W. in Florida.
Hi, Chloe.
NDM number 26, Anita A. in Kansas. Hi, Anita. NDM number 27, Denise G. in Massachusetts.
Hi, Denise.
NDM number 28, Chris G. in Washington. Hi, Chris. NDM number 29, Trisha B. in North Carolina. Hi, Trisha. NDM number 30, Jackie G. in Georgia.
Hi, Jackie.
NDM number 31, Jamie B. in Colorado. Hi, Jamie.
Hi, Jamie.
NDM number 32, Kelly O. in Ohio.
Hi, Kelly.
NDH number 15, Mark M. in New Jersey.
Hi, Mark.
NDH number 16, Sergio I. in Ohio.
Hey, Sergio.
NDT number 19, Matt W. in England. Hi, Matt. NDT number 20, Caroline S. in Alabama.
Hi, Caroline.
Miss you, girl. NDW number 17, Rachel W. in Kansas.
Hi, Rachel.
NDW number 18, Mary W. in Arkansas.
Hi, Mary.
We are so glad that you decided to stand up and be counted. If you, too, want a position on the NDP roster, please write to us at becounted@thedisneydrivenlife.com. Be sure to give us your first name, your last initial, your home state, your Twitter handle if you have one, and let us know, do you want to be a mom, dad, grandmom, granddad, husband, wife, auntie, uncle, individual, teen, or kid? That would be all that we have for you this week. Thanks for tuning into Inner Mouse. We'll see you next week.
Thank you very much, guys.
Live the life.
Peach out.